Okay, we're going to review a few facts about nutrition. A lot of this should be very simple overview of things that you already know. So to begin with, nutrition refers to the ingested substances that fuel metabolism, provide building blocks for growth and repair, and maintain function of tissues. The primary nutritional consideration is energy or calories. And so only certain substances that you eat or consume provide this resource. So things like proteins and carbs and fats can all be broken down into components that provide fuel or energy. And so this chart is from the Sapolsky book, the Zebra book, and it's really important to memorize or to understand. And so let's go through it a little. So on the left is what you stick in your mouth. So what do you eat? You eat proteins, starches, sugars, carbs, and fat. So that is the form that you eat. How it winds up in your bloodstream is amino acids, glucose, fatty acids, and glycerol. So this is the very basic component of these. And then how do we store it? Well, we store it in the form of protein, glycogen, and triglycerides. And then when we need to mobilize energy stores, so during the stress response or the fight or flight, then we break it down again into amino acids, glucose, and fatty acids. So after we've stored triglycerides, the only difference is that we can break it down into ketone bodies later on. And so that's not necessarily going to be the most important factor, but understand that in the bloodstream, it is floating around in the most basic broken down components, and then we store it in the more larger complex components. And then in terms of energy sources, carbohydrates can be broken down very easily. So actually you have enzymes in your mouth. So you could put a cracker in your mouth and it would be broken down because carbohydrates can be broken down very easily, get released into the bloodstream very quickly, but they're not the most, they don't provide the most energy of all the nutrients. Lipids really actually provide a lot more calories than carbs. And then you have your vitamins and minerals. And so these are components that don't contribute to energy. And so, you know, taking a multivitamin or whatever is not going to be enough fuel to sustain you, to live. So, but they play a really, really key important role. And so take a moment and before you read this slide, try to remember what function of vitamins and minerals, what are the functions of these components? So in the very beginning of the semester, we talked about, enzymes and metabolic reactions and that you need these cofactors and coenzymes. And so this is where vitamins and minerals play a role. They help catalyze those reactions to make them faster and more efficient. And so if you don't have these, then some of those reactions that you really need to survive get slowed down. Essential substances. So you don't necessarily have to memorize all of the different essential substances, but I do want you to know the definition. And so essential, anytime you see that word, means that you can't make it. So, there's so many chemical reactions involved in metabolism, and some of the substrates that we need to power additional reactions, we can make. We can break things down and build things up. But essential substances are components, whether it's minerals, vitamins, sometimes you have amino acids that are essential. Your body can't make those. And so you have to eat them. Assessment of nutritional status. So, excuse me, we have, multiple ways to really assess nutritional status. And they have a range of sensitivity. So and then they pick up nutritional status at different points. And so let's talk about some of them. So growth slows. That is like the end point, right? It, you know, if we only are looking at growth, then we're really looking at the end point. And this is going to be the same for the flip side too. So if we're looking at like obesity, which is also malnutrition, and we're only looking at weight and BMI, we're kind of coming to the game a little bit late. And so it also has a low sensitivity in terms of being able to tell you what a person's nutritional status is. We do have biochemical measures of nutrient stores. And so this would be like your albumin or your microalbumin. We talked about that when we were talking about edema. And so that could be a way that you could test with a lab test. So the other way is really just asking someone what they eat and having a dietary intake and a dietary history, because you can often, you know, that'll pick up, it's more sensitive, it'll pick up more nutritional deficiencies or excesses. But clinically, you know, in a doctor's office, we really look at these measures way down here. So let's talk about malnutrition, because this can be a little bit confusing. So malnutrition includes deficiencies or excesses of vitamins, minerals, calories, and energy substrates. So primary undernutrition or starvation is usually what people think of when they think of malnutrition. And so you can have marasmus, which is total caloric undernutrition, or you can have kwashiorkor. And that's when the, you know, the little toddlers have the big bellies because they have effusions in their abdomen because they have protein deficiency. And remember, if you have protein deficiency, you have albumin deficiency. If you have albumin deficiency, you have a low osmotic pressure. And so the net flow of fluid is out of your capillaries. And so this is what shows up, these big bellies. And so malnutrition really has differential effects according to when you experienced it. And so someone who's experiencing malnutrition really early on in childhood or during prenatal development, their health outcomes are going to be more affected, and the impacts are going to be more significant than if you maybe, you know, as an adult, had a short period of time where you were malnourished. You also have secondary undernutrition, and this is cachexia. And this is anything that says secondary is really like the next step. And so it's not primarily due to like a lack of intake. It's due to something else that is causing this. And so oftentimes we see this in cancer, in HIV, in a lot of like chronic illnesses that really increase muscle wasting and weakness. And, you know, it also leads to all of these other problems, which are probably due to some of the, you know, vitamin deficiencies. The pathophysiology is a little complex, but it involves cytokines and inflammation. And basically you have a decrease in muscle protein synthesis, and you have an increase in breaking down those proteins. You have an increase in your resting metabolic rate. You have reduced activity of key enzymes. You have, and it might also lead to like a reduced intake, but it's not primarily due to that. It's primarily due to some other factor. So here is a image just showing how this works, and you can see some familiar words, right? So it has to do with, you know, inflammation, but basically this is an inappropriate use and an inappropriate mobilization of stores of energy. The other type of malnutrition that people often don't think of is obesity. And so obesity, clinically defined as a BMI greater than 30, pathophysiology is complex. At the very basic sense, it results from an imbalance in calories in versus calories out. It is related to a lot of common causes of morbidity and mortality. Certain populations are predisposed to obesity. This is something that is one of those situations where we have, it's a correlation to so many different things. So it's now become its own diagnosis and its own disease. And so we've gone beyond, heart attacks and high cholesterol to now pathologizing body size. And this is a complex issue, but just know for our purposes that obesity is also a form of malnutrition.